Good afternoon, everyone. This is my great pleasure to be here today. First of all, I would like to thank the Committee of Pet Fair Southeast Asia Conference for giving me this opportunity. Our conversation today will focus on canine hypothyroidism. As you all know, hypothyroidism, from now on, I will call it hypo-T, is the condition that too low level of the thyroid hormone were detected in our patient's circulation. However, it was divided into three categories: the primary, the secondary hypothyroidism, and the last one is euthyroid 6 syndrome. Let's go through the detail of the difference among these three types. The primary hypothyroidism is the condition that thyroid gland itself was destructed, so it lacked thyroid hormone even though a huge of TSH level from the anterior pituitary gland was released to stimulate the thyroid gland to release more thyroid. Idiopathic atrophy of the thyroid gland and lymphocytic thyroiditis are the two most common causes of this type. The secondary hypothyroidism denoted an impairment of the pituitary gland to secrete the TSH, causing the secondary thyroid follicular atrophy. This mechanism responsible for less than 5% of the cases, pituitary tumor, pituitary malformation, and isolated TSH deficiency are possible causes. Euthyroid 6 syndrome or non-thyroidal illness is the condition that the other severe or the chronic illness cause the body to reduce the HPT axis function. So, both TSH and thyroid hormone are below normal level. As mentioned in the previous slides, primary destruction of the thyroid gland is the most common cause of this disease. More than 95% of the cases are acquired. Idiopathic atrophy of the gland and lymphocytic thyroiditis are the two most common causes of the thyroid gland loss. Congenital or juvenile onset of hypo-T, neoplastic destruction of the thyroid gland and idiopathic hypo-T can also occur, but much less common. All clinical signs gradually develop whenever thyroid gland was destroyed more than 80%. At this point, it implied that the late diagnosis of this disease often occur. So, are there anything that can help us to diagnose this disease sooner? Dr. Firm's study in 2009 suggested that there are some changes showing before the clinical signs. So, let's see this table. If we divided hypothyroidism stage into four phases, subclinical canine lymphocytic thyroiditis, subclinical hypothyroidism, antibody over hypothyroidism or the early stage canine lymphocytic thyroiditis, and the last one is the end stage canine lymphocytic thyroiditis. Most of our cases fall into this stage, the end stage phase, or if we are lucky, they might be detected in the early stage of the hypothyroidism, since the clinical signs of this disease can be detected in only these two stages. When we compare to most common causes of primary hypothyroidism, the lymphocytic thyroiditis and idiopathic thyroiditis, it is hard to say which one is the most common. However, the distribution profile of three types of this disease was studied in 2007, and the results show in this picture. In subclinical thyroiditis, most of the patients can be diagnosed in the 1 year of age. In contrast, the most common age that was diagnosed to be lymphocytic thyroiditis and idiopathic thyroiditis are the 3 years and 7 years respectively. From this information, it is likely that the lymphocytic thyroiditis is more common in the younger dog compared to the idiopathic type of lymphocytic might be the early characteristic of the idiopathic thyroiditis. All this information implies that the incidence of canine hypothyroidism is much earlier than we think. In previous study on predisposing breed of this disease were reported quite rarely. In 1981, the US data was reported the most common breed of this disease are Doberman Pinscher, Gradient, and Poodle. However, in 2000 was reported from Sweden that most common breed are Jack and Schnauzer and Hoverwort. The variation of predisposing breed might be from the favorite breed during that era or the area prevalent. Unfortunately, there is no report in Thailand yet. However, we found that Thai Bangal is the one of our clinic fan club, so that Bangal might be one of the most common predisposing breed of this disease in Thailand. Besides Thai Bangal, Poodle, Pomeranian, and Golden Retriever are the most common breed that are noted for this disease in Thailand. Thyroid function primarily working on the body metabolism, so that it involves most of the metabolic hormone. Therefore, when thyroid hormone is too low, the typical signs of this disease including lethargy, inactivity, weight gain, skin lesion, are displayed. Moreover, some clinical features of this disease are also noted, such as neurological, cardiovascular, and renal signs. When we focus on hematology characteristic, non-regenerative anemia, hyperlipidemia, hypercholesterolemia, and increased liver profile are demonstrated in this condition. In summary, the report show the most common clinical feature of hypothyroidism are obesity, alopecia, lethargy, and hypercholesterolemia, which are reported more than 40% of the case, followed by pyoderma, dry hair coat, and bradycardia, which are reported about 10 to 15% of the cases. The last critical feature of the case are facial paralysis, vestibular disease, hyporeflexia, KCS, and neuropathy. As mentioned earlier, Hypercholesterolemia was reported about 75% of hypotensive cases. However, skin lesion is much higher. 88 of the hypotensive cases display bilateral symmetric non-proliferative alopecia, as well as hair loss in the area of increased swelling, which is usually ventral thorax, neck, and ventral abdomen. Most of the hair follicles are in the telogen phase of the hair cycle, and hyperpigmentation was in place in the area of chronic inflammation. So, it looks like hypothyroidism is all about the skin size. Why must we concern about this disease? If we carefully think about the hypothyroidism, it is not all about the skin disease. Many of its other symptoms make us more concerned, such as bradycardia, facial paralysis, and vestibular disease. Even the critical condition of this disease, which is called myxedema coma. The myxedema coma is reported as a very rare condition in this disease. The clinical characteristics of this condition include weakness, stupor, coma, hypothermia, bradycardia, hypotension, and hypoventilation. Some of the cases were reported as hyponatremia as well. This characteristic is much life-threatening, so make hypotension more important for us to make a serious care. Compared to human, the mortality rate of myxedema coma in humans ranging from 15 to 60, while myxedema coma is rare in animals. Much of what is known in veterinary medicine is based on a few case reports, or is taken from human medicine. The development of myxedema coma requires a precipitating event that overwhelms normal homeostasis. In humans, it is often an infection, whereas in animals, no single event has been repeatedly identified. The common finding of myxedema coma patients are change in mental status, altered thermoregulation, and non-pitting skin edema. Edema localizing in brain is responsible for the development of augmentation. Hyponatremia can cause a further decrease in neurological status. Patients with myxedema coma are often hypothermic, but not shivering. In the hypothyroid stage, there is decreased activity of enzymes, resulting decrease in ATP use. ATP is the powerhouse of the cells, and with the decreased activity, there is decreased oxygen consumption, and thus decreased heat generation, decreased ventilation and perfusion, which display as the hypoventilation and hypotension. Up to date, there are only 6 publications reported myxedema coma in dogs, comparing to 485 publications reported in humans. So, it is quite wondering if myxedema coma is really rare in veterinary medicine or it is underestimated. There is so many reported in human medicine on diseases and conditions associated with hypotension, such as pediatric Down syndrome, hyperlipidemia, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, restless leg syndrome, and CKD. So, if there are so many concurrent diseases in human hypotea, how about canine hypotea? Is it rare or is it misdiagnosed? That's all my first part of my talk. So what we learned from it? The prevalence of canine primary hypothyroidism possibly more than what we found. If the early diagnosis can be done, is it useful for us for preventing the serious concurrent condition? Let's move to the diagnostic tool of this disease. The gold standard of diagnosis is the TSH simulation test, which is the exogenous TSH is administered to the dog, and then the pre-TSH and post-TSH thyroxines were measured. As mentioned earlier, the TSH stimulation is non-invasive gold standard for thyroid function, since it significantly different the primary hypotea from the secondary hypotea and euthyroid 6 syndrome. This test is recommended for confirming the diagnosis, especially when serum canine TSH is normal and non-thyroidal units is present. The details show in this illustrator. The first two scatterplot is the pre-TSS stim and the post-TSS stim of the hypo-T group. You can appreciate to see the level of T4 both the basal and the post-stim are in the same level. So it means that the exogenous TSH would fail to trigger the extra release of T4 from the thyroid gland, since the thyroid gland was destroyed. In contrast, the basal T4 of the euthyroid group quite valid and a little bit higher than the typo T group. Moreover, after TSH stimulation, endogenous T4 can release from the thyroid group because thyroid can't work properly. Cosini and co-workers suggest the cutoff point of post-TSH stim T4 for the primary hypotea group is less than 1.3 microgram per deciliter. However, when the post-TSH stim T4 was higher than 1.7 microgram per deciliter, suggests that patient is unlikely to be suffer from the hypotea. Although this test is recommended as the gold standard of the diagnostic test for this disease, the burden of cost for testing is so high. Since TSS is very expensive and has to be cheap cooling all the times, so it is not quite available all area, also not available in our area as well. For this reason, the alternative diagnostic test is recommended. Now, shall we focus on the recommended alternative tests? The first two alternative tests I will go through are total T4 and free T4. Although the T3 or triiodothyronine has a higher potency than the thyroxine or T4, but it is not stable, and the cost for setting up of this to measure this marker is so high, so that most of the diagnostic laboratory recommend to measure T4 or free T4 instead. The radioimmunoassay has a higher sensitivity and specificity than chemiluminescent immunoassay. However, the radioisotope is the hazard material, so that the chemiluminescent was replaced to do so. Recently, chemiluminescent has been approved to be similar to and has a consistent result to RIA. Most of the total T4 measurement machine using the technique based on chemiluminescent. The serum-free T4 is another story. The standard technique for measurement free T4 is equilibrium dialysis or ED. However, it is not available worldwide, so that semi-automated chemiluminescent has been determined to be correspond to free T4 by ED. The sensitivity of chemiluminescent for free T4 are 62% in human and 75% in dogs respectively. And the percentage of false negative is very low, both in human and veterinary field. Please note that free T4 should not be used for screening alone. The last diagnostic tool for hypo-T is the serum TSH level, which is can be differentiated primary hypo-T from the secondary hypo-T and euthyroid 6 syndrome. In the primary hypo-T, the increased level of TSH is displayed, while the latter are below normal. Serum TSH is a species-specific method. Most of the TSH assay is commonly used in chemiluminescent technique. TSH should be interpreted with the serum total T4 and free T4. Since the 20 to 40% of the type T dog has a normal TSH level. From this previous slide, you can see the increase in TSH detected earlier than the change of free T4 as well as the clinical size changes. Another assay that is also interesting is the thyroglobulin autoantibody or TGAA. This assay based on the ELISA method and also species specific. From this study, they found the change in thyroglobulin antibody increase since the stage of subclinical canine lymphocytic thyroiditis, which might be possible detected in 1 year old dog. So, if we can set up the thyroglobulin autoantibody assay in our region, the earliest detection of this disease can be possible. Therefore, we can prevent the serious concurrent disease of hypo-T. Remind you of this slide, most of our patients were diagnosed at the end stage of the thyroiditis, which is the idiopathic thyroiditis. If we can diagnose our patient since the subclinical thyroiditis, it means that we can start to take care of our patient at least 4 years before or even when we detected our patient at the stage of the lymphocytic thyroiditis, we still also take care of our patient at least 3 years earlier than usual. So here the suggestion of our practical hypo-T diagnosis in our region. Dr. Graham study in 2007. He suggests that the sensitivity, specificity, and accuracy of low T4 and high TSH is 80, 97, and 86% respectively. However, when free T4 by ED is not available in our area, if we use total T4 and TSH instead, the sensitivity, specificity, and accuracy of low T4 and high TSH is 87, 92, and 82% respectively. So it means equivocal of free T4 and total T4. The standard treatment of canine hypothyroidism is thyroxine supplement. The starting dose which is recommended is 20 microgram per kg every 12 hours if the tablet was supplement, or 20 microgram per kg every 24 hours if the solution was given. Both type of medication should give before meal and at least 4 to 8 hours before re-measure. The day for follow-up, the medication should be given 4 to 6 hours prior to testing. So that if clinical signs improve, such as the activity become increased and the result come back as T4 is higher than 6 microgram per deciliter, the reduced dosage was recommended and recheck again in next 4 weeks. If the T4 is normal or normal height, no change in dosage is needed and recheck again in 6 months. If the T4 still low and TSH still high, increased dosage is needed and recheck again in next 4 weeks. In contrast, if the clinical signs does not improve and T4 still normal or higher than normal, the re-evaluation is recommended. However, if we found the low T4 and high TSH in the checkup today, the increased dosage is needed and recheck both T4 and TSH again in next 8 weeks. After 8 weeks of new levothyroxine dosage, 4 hours post medication, T4 and TSH were assessed with the clinical signs. If the clinical signs improve, the schedule plan would be the same as the second last slide. However, if the clinical signs does not improve, the re-evaluation and increased dosage is recommended. If the increased dosage is recommended, recheck again in next 8 weeks. Now, we move to the question asked if subclinical hypothyroidism is needed to be treated. The suggestion from human research is to supplement levothyroxine whenever there is one of following result in diagnostic testing display: the low total T4, the normal total T4 with the positive thyroglobulin autoantibody, the normal total T4 and the high TSH. However, please note that both overtreatment and hypotreatment lead to serious cardiovascular risks, so that closely monitor is recommended. In conclusion, the study from Human Medicine suggested to treat subclinical hypothyroidism when TSH is higher than 4.5 milliunit per liter in the patient age less than 65 years old to reduce risks of concurrent disease. However, if the patient is older than 65 years old, the treatment should be start when TSH is higher than 7 milliunit per liter. Why we have to treat them like this? Meta-analysis show the increased risk of heart failure, coronary heart disease, and mortality from coronary heart disease when TSH is higher than 10 milliunit per liter compared to the normal TSH value, and the alteration in lipid pattern is increased in patients with grade 2 subclinical hypothyroidism. Before I finish my talk today, here is my take-home message for you. The early diagnosis might be beneficial for protecting life-threatening concurrent disease. Either over or hypotreatment of this disease lead to the serious complications such as cardiovascular risks. Routine checkup for thyroid profile, the canine thyroglobulin autoantibody, TSH, the total T4 or the free T4 in the middle-aged dog could be useful. The TSH with total T4 or TSH with free T4 used to be used together for interpreting this disease. That's all my talk today. Thank you so much for your attention and I appreciate it. Thank you.
Little Trimellos have a story to tell about how to make rabbits, guinea pigs, chinchillas and daegus happy. They contain more than 42 plants from untreated natural meadows, plus nutrients and vitamins for a perfectly balanced mix. We put nature in a new form, a huge variety in a single Trimello. Rich in raw fibers and with a balanced composition, our Trimellos can be fed with no worry or weighing. Just fill up the bowl and let them eat it all up. The shape is perfectly tailored to the natural chewing and eating behavior. A huge, no-worries package full of plants, nutrients, and vitamins combined in a single Trimello. Trimello, the original. No worries, balanced feeding with Bunny.